आ रही मैं नो इफ आई एम एबल टू, क्या मेरी आवाज आ रही है फ्रेंड्स? डॉक्टर सोमू सिंह, अगर आप हमें सिग्नल दे दें। सर यू आर लाइव नाउ। ओके गुड, वेलकम सर। पतंजलि मिश्रा जी नमस्कार, क्या मेरी आवाज आ रही है डॉक्टर पतंजलि मिश्रा? एक बार आप, ओके भुवन महापात्रा जी, थैंक यू सो मच। फ्रेंड्स लेट मी स्टार्ट नाउ। बिफोर आई स्टार्ट आई थॉट आई विल थैंक डॉक्टर सोमू सिंह एंड ऑल अदर्स दोज हु आर इन्वॉल्व विद दिस पेज, दिस ग्रुप ऑन फेसबुक, एंड एस्पेशली एट ए टाइम व्हेन वी आर ऑल फेसिंग अ क्राइसिस टाइम एंड सच अ वंडरफुल इनिशिएटिव दैट हैज बीन टेकन बाय डॉक्टर सोमू सिंह। आई वंस अगेन आई कंग्रेचुलेट हिम एंड ऑल्सो आई थैंक ऑल दो स्पीकर्स, प्रीवियस स्पीकर्स हु हैव बीन हेल्पिंग डॉक्टर सोमू सिंह टू रीच टू द ऑल दोज बी एड स्टूडेंट्स, एम एड स्टूडेंट्स हु आर देयर इन रिमोटेस्ट कॉर्नर्स। आई हैव बीन सीइंग the feedbacks coming from live feedbacks coming from students from Orissa, Bihar and all parts of the country. That was very encouraging. Friends, the topic that I have taken for today's session is the rise of MOOCs and corollary to educational research. That is what I am going to talk about. The topic that I have chosen is can be for two reasons. One is that the domain of research, the research in the area of MOOCs, is as it is, has to be done. There is a strong need to go for research in this area, independent of what the scenario that we are facing because of COVID-19. On the other hand, because of the COVID-19 scenario as well, there is a demand for the online remote learning, and that there is an implication for us that we need to go for research in this field. In both the cases, in both the way, whether we are doing in a normal way the research in the area of MOOCs, or because of this, in both the scenario, there is a much need of doing research. Okay. So, friends, I am from, my name is Madhusudan. I am from University of Hyderabad, situated in the southern part of India, in the city of Hyderabad. Recently, university has been conferred with Institute of Eminence. I am proud to be part of such a wonderful university, known for its world-class research and teaching. If I have to talk about this topic, today's presentation, what I'm going to do is let us have it in five parts or sections. In the first section, I'll be talking about introduction to MOOCs, because most of the participants here are, I understand, are from B.Ed. and M.Ed. background. So let me have a brief basic introduction to MOOCs so that that may benefit them. And in the second part, in the second section, I'll be talking about the rise of MOOCs. Ever since the word MOOC has been introduced, let us say from the year 2008, or ever since MOOCs have really introduced from 2012 or 13, till date, not exactly the trend of research that we are going to, but we are going to talk about how the rise of MOOCs has taken place over a period of time. Then quickly, I'll move on to the third section, wherein I'll be talking about the research in MOOCs, the areas of research in MOOCs, the need for research in MOOCs, the methodology in which by which the researchers are engaging, the types of research that is taking place, this is what we will talk about in third section. And in the fourth section, I will be talking about implications for educational research. Ultimately, when we are talking about MOOCs, when we are talking about the rise of MOOCs, and when we talk about the need for research in the area of MOOCs, finally, what are the implications? What are its corollary to educational research? Because ultimately, when we talk about MOOCs, if we talk about the quality of MOOCs, it is ultimately connected with the instructional design, instructional science that you and me, we are talking about. That is, we are in the field of education. Therefore, there is a needed implications for educational research. And in the end, I'll be taking few questions. We'll have some discussions. What I request participants is, instead of simultaneous taking questions, you put questions in the chat box when or where, whatever you feel like. I'll be taking up in the end once I finish four sections. Okay, friends. Now I will be taking you to the introduction to MOOCs. When we say MOOCs, these two, like this abbreviation, will come to our mind that it's massive online open courses. And general literature tells us about what actually I mean by massive. Massive here may mean in terms of enrollment. So therefore, it is large enrollments. So therefore, maybe let us call it as massive when we call about MOOCs. Other parties, online. Here, there is no mandatory qualification and open to all. So therefore, we try to call it as open as well, because it is fully online. And lastly, courses. When we say courses, it is a structured course content, because it is designed by an experienced teacher, instructor. So this is what we get, a simple abbreviation of MOOCs. However, when I searched a lot of literature to understand the basics of MOOCs, the background of MOOCs, in order to understand more, what I found is, I found a very interesting paper. This paper, the reference of this I have given here. This paper, he has identified several definitions. At least some 10-15 definitions he has given. This author, he has given collected definitions. One such definition is Stevens in 2013. This definition is very interesting for all of us. We need to understand the definition of MOOCs in terms of what has been given by Stephen. He says, first, number one, when he says massive, it's not just about enrollments. He says it's about the scale. And also when he says about the scale, it is about, because MOOCs rely on increased chance of interactions from a critical mass of participants. There is a huge number of participants. They will be interacting inside the course. So therefore, it's about this, in terms of scale, it is about massive because of the number of the students. And number two, within that massive, he means it allows knowledge to derive more from participants and less from top down. Here, instructor's role is very important, very crucial. However, in addition to the instructor's inputs, it's about the participants who interact with each other. So that way it is massive in terms of number of participants. So therefore, massive here, he takes it in that sense. Second, he goes to open. Open here, he refers to not just free. Normally we understand it as free, but here he says not just free, but it should have open access. Open access to each and everyone, irrespective of the place or whatever situations they are. And even it is open in terms of syllabus, flexibility, that allows participants to drive their own learning. And online is, which is essential. Online, which is very much essential. So therefore, here, internet introduces abundance. The very important concept here, when we say online, it's altogether a different game. Like here, it introduces the abundance. There is no scarcity now. On the other hand, the completely different playing field from one based on scarcity. The normal, our traditional university classroom situations are not based on online, therefore they are based on scarcity. Here, the scarcity has been removed and suddenly the abundance has been introduced because of the online. Then lastly, the most important thing is course. And when we talk about course, it will have structure. And it's based on a very well experienced teacher. Teacher has created this course. So therefore, when Stevens talks about MOOCs, he talks in this fashion. And there are many other definitions given in this reference that I have given here. They all will be very useful for anyone who is interested in going for further understanding of this. Now, let me go further. In the year 2008, these two gentlemen, especially Stephen Downs, right side, one who is right side to the in this slide, Stephen Downs started talking about connectivist distributed peer learning model. And then suddenly John Siemens, these two people came together and they have introduced the word called MOOCs. And ever since, a lot of experiments started taking place. A lot of individuals, institutions, universities, corporate level as well, market, they all started working on how technology gets enabled and with the help of videos, with the help of other activities, how we can provide the course online. So some works have taken place and rest is the history as we all know. Some of the examples, just for example only, I'm talking here. At international level, we know very famous platforms that provide MOOCs. They include Coursera, edX we have, Udacity we have, FutureLearn. Canvas is another platform, OpenStudy as well. These are international level courses that are available. These courses, some of the courses are paid courses, some are free courses. Not all courses are free courses. It depends upon the interest of the learner. It depends upon the interest of the participant, the student, what he is going to pursue. Some of the courses, for example, in Coursera, you may go through. If you opt not to go for certificate, you can learn. So that possibilities are also there in these kind of courses. Or on the other hand, if you want to have a certificate kind of thing, maybe you may have to pay certain amount of fee that has been decided for each in that particular course. On the other hand, in our country, we have our own indigenous MOOCs, our own Swayam platform. Swayam platform is considered to be one of the very innovative idea in terms of providing MOOCs catering to the various levels of audiences and various institutions ranging from IITs, universities, institutes like National Institute of Open School, all have their own roles to play in Swayam, and Swayam to a great extent is able to provide MOOCs in our country. And most of these courses, almost all the courses are free of course. So these are some of the examples only I was talking about. Now, if we go further, who is taking these courses at international level or wherever, we are what is there actually, we see that there are courses. Individuals are interested for various reasons. Like for example, there are courses which are of vocational in nature. So therefore, individuals may be interested in going for vocational courses. So such courses can be classified as MOOCs courses, as vocational courses. There are other courses, like for example, educators are interested. Like for example, there are courses in Swayam. We teachers also interested, maybe for part of refresher courses or for learning or upgrading our own skills. So even educators are interested in going through the courses, and even researchers, they can learn skills. For example, there is a course called R, research methodology courses. So whatever skill you a researcher needed, there are specific courses. And most of the students at higher education these days, there is a credit transfer system. So therefore, students at higher education are also interested in going through these MOOC courses. And there may be other target groups, like they may be learning only for hobby. So they may be called as hobby learners. There can be hobby courses as well. And sometimes prospective students, they may test their aptitude in advance. They want to undergo certain courses. So prospective students also take up on their own. It's a self-initiated way they take, and they also do certain time. And coming to pedagogy that goes into MOOCs, it's a very combination of various activities actually. It's not subject to one single issue. It's about engaging learner in whatsoever manner with the help of technology. The top of this is video lectures. One of the most important thing that becomes essential, not exactly essential, like becomes central to any MOOCs course is video lectures. And delivered through videos, sometimes short videos, depending upon the requirement. And assessment, of course, just like any other course, is most important part of MOOCs. There are forums. There are discussion forums. They could be topic-based discussion forums. There could be issue-based discussion forums. Discussion forums are used in a variety of fashion in these courses. And instructor, because he's an experienced teacher, so he can give suggested readings. In addition to whatever he has delivered through video, he can give suggested readings, of which students, learners on their own, they can go for. And sometimes, for example, I was part of a Canvas online course called Technology Enabled Learning for Teachers. They have weekly live video sessions. So MOOCs can have live video sessions depending upon weekly or whatever periodicity that is possible for them. Live video session is also another very interesting thing that we, and various activities are there. That is what makes the strong this MOOC pedagogy. And sometimes additional video resources are also provided, not necessarily made by teacher or the instructor. They are all they may be open education resources available. Best of the videos are available in each of the subjects. One can browse, and teacher feels like supplying additional resources. And the presence of social media, for example, Twitter, Facebook, for example, can be used very well for learner engagement. And most of these learning management systems, most of these MOOCs, they embed social media platforms. It has got its own utility. Like, for example, for me, if you ask me, I take Twitter as a very powerful education tool. So therefore, all these combinations have come into considered as MOOCs pedagogy. Then researchers, experienced experts in the field of MOOCs, they give credit to theories, especially these theories. Vygotsky's theory, they say it's central to the creation of MOOCs. Similarly, when we talk about theories, it is about connectivism theory that is central to creation of MOOCs. And experts also have opinion that the most of the MOOCs are based on social constructivist theory. And of course, we were talking about the social media models for e-collaboration. And the very interesting one is about item response theory. So these are theory-based. The MOOCs have to be, and MOOCs are theory-based in terms of their development, design, and delivery of any MOOC course. It has got a strong theory background. Now I'm taking you to the second part. When I completed the first part, that is introduction to MOOCs, I'm taking you to the second part. In second part, I would like to talk to you about the rise of MOOCs. When we talk about rise of MOOCs, the year 2012 is taken as the year of the MOOC. People suddenly they said year 2012 as the year of the MOOC. However, people here, when we talk about the rise of MOOCs, people are divided. There is a possible intense debate among the stakeholders, among the teachers, among the course instructors, among the students. So there is a debate that some say it's a doom. They say it's the end of the universities. Teachers are going to lose their jobs. This is one way of thinking. On the other hand, other set of people, they are at a denial mode and they say no, it's just a hype. And once hype fades, business as usual will resume. They don't believe that universities are going to be replaced, whatever may be. These are the two scenarios that possible is there. So when media reports, if you have to go in the year 2012, they said it is the year of MOOC. But what happened in the next 1 year, by the end of the 2013, the same report just started saying that it was only it's a media hype. Nothing like that. So the way what people have said in 2012, now we are in 2020, not much has but unfortunately what happened when we talk about the rise of MOOCs kind of thing, people start talking about as though something disruptive technology has come that way. So sometimes exaggeration may take place, but still nevertheless, so we need to pay attention to the kind of rise that is taking place in the field of MOOCs. I request your attention to this gentleman's statement. He says, if we have to believe this, at least he made a very good statement. He says, within 50 years, there would be only 10 institutions of higher learning left in the world. He says, it's a very strong statement, it's a bold statement. And the time frame that he has given is 50 years. He says, within 50 years, there would be only 10 institutions of higher learning left in the world. And of course, because he is the boss of the Udacity, and he says Udacity might be one of them. Of course, you believe it, this statement? You don't believe it? That's an issue, but at least he made, and we can think about this. Why, in what context this statement has been made, and what is the trend of that signals something about the trend of MOOCs that may take place. At least you see, traditional universities and institutions are already facing some adaptive challenges. You and me, we have to understand this. Because of MOOCs, presence of MOOCs, the teachers, the traditional universities and institutions are already facing adaptive challenges. We are started adapting, adjusting, and there is a pressure. There is a guidelines for at least in our own context. So for example, at least 20% of the courses can be made online. So slowly, maybe there may be increase. I would like to put two examples here when I'm talking about the rise, in order to understand the rise of MOOCs. I would like to put two examples in front of you. Very interesting, very serious. Number one example is, it says, the number of students who completed my MOOC is approximately equal to the number of students I have had in the classroom in my entire career. This has been said by a MOOC professor, as reported by the reference given here. This is something very interesting. Say, for example, I have been teaching for 18 years, or somebody who's teaching for 20 years. Average, if somebody is teaching every year 100 students, just imagine how many students they are doing over a period of 18 years, 20 years. But this professor, this gentleman who in his MOOC course got in just 1 year or in last few MOOC courses the equal number of students that were he has been teaching for, say, last 18-20 years. So that's very interesting thing that he has made. Another example, let us take example from marketing. Here there is one course, MSc Computer Science program at Georgia Tech University. And the cost of online course is $7,000. On the other hand, for the same course in the same institution, it is $20,000. This is for local students. And the same course, if the student is out of the state, if the student is not from that place, it costs 40,000. So just imagine, a student would like to go if he feels better, if he is comfortable online taking MOOCs, he will pay more and go there, and he will pay less and he is earning the same degree. So therefore, these two examples are indicating something to us. Now, I will take you further. There are other kind of experts, not that they will believe the way I am believing. There is another kind of people, they will say, this is very interesting article I found. He says, life after MOOCs. He says, when will massive open online courses disappear? He is questioning, and he believes, yes, MOOCs are going to disappear. And he is thinking about the life that is there after MOOCs. Very interesting idea, very interesting viewpoint he holds. We need to respect that. So possibility is that it's not just about exaggeration and hype that we need to talk about the MOOCs. We can have a balanced view on this. So therefore, I brought this article to you. There is another interesting article I found. Is this article is a brief guide to understanding MOOCs. Here, he makes a very interesting points. He says, understand that MOOCs are a stage in online education evolution. He says online education is going through an evolution process. MOOC is not a new thing. MOOC is also one stage. We need to understand that MOOCs are a stage. You never know what is going to come tomorrow. So therefore, it's not that MOOCs are what we have to live with. But in the same article, he makes very few interesting points. He says, you and me, we need to understand. He says, no. Know that instructor's role has changed. He says, very importantly, because of the MOOCs, there is a pressure on teachers, and the role as a teacher has changed from a traditional teaching to the facilitator kind of things. We have been talking, but now in reality it has come. And also he says, know that active learner participation is crucial. Here, who takes MOOCs, the student, he's an active learner. And also, he says, know that the learners will be independent and frequently out of sight. We are used to talk to students on day-to-day basis, see them, teach them. But here in MOOCs, we don't have to see them. And he says, understand that the learner will engage with other learners and ideas. This is a very interesting thing. Learner from a country, learner from a B country, with varied language differences, cultural backgrounds, will interact with each other. They learn from each other. And he also tells, understand that the final knowledge will be negotiated. That is a very interesting point he is making. And he says, accept that your ownership of the knowledge does not exist. He is talking to teachers. He says, it's no more the, so we need to be, stay relevant. So he says that accept that your ownership of the knowledge does not exist. There is no more sage on the stage. Those days have gone. Now, I'll go further. And I bring to your kind attention one short story. I thought it is very interesting and relevant. I recently came across in one of the workshops in Wardha. I was attending one of the participants from Vishwabharati University. He brought to my knowledge this piece of information. This is from a chapter from a 9th standard CBSE English textbook. The chapter was Fun They Had. And the story was, I have to be short actually. The story was set in a future, maybe after a few years, and children are playing, and suddenly they found something called a book, and they were worried, or they are asking their elders in the family, grandparents maybe, and what is this? They understand that it's a book, and the concluding thing when they say what is book, how used to be, and why they used to see the book, because they used to school. What is school? Acha, there is a school. So in the school, who used to teach? Teacher used to teach. But that way, the dialogue ends, they say, they had a teacher and it was a man. Maybe in future, Maybe it's for humor if I am bringing, but never know what may be there in our this thing. Now, I'll take you to the third part of my presentation. After introduction to MOOCs and a little bit understanding of the rise of MOOCs, I will let us now get into research in MOOCs. With the help of scientific database that are available in my university and from open education resources and also open education resources, especially EBSCO and ERIC databases, I found at least some 600 very well written articles, research papers. And when I quickly went through them, these are the topics most of the researchers are talking about, like for example dropout, why there is a less number of students they pass out from MOOCs. Take for example SWAYAM alone. Enrollment wise there is a huge number, but how many are passing, it is very less. So what could be the reasons this kind of research is taking place? Some researchers are doing difference between comparative study between MOOCs and a real class traditional courses. Some courses like learning coverage in MOOCs, assessment, which is part of the central part of MOOCs, and it's finding very interesting area of research. Learner perceptions, what learners are thinking about the courses, their experiences have to be documented scientifically. This type of researchers are also taking place. Teachers' perception is also important. What teachers, what instructors, what those who are preparing MOOCs are also thinking about. And the one important area of research should be, and of course, is quality. What are the factors that determine the quality of research? Again, characteristics of MOOC learner, community of practices. Very innovative, various practices are taking place in the field of MOOCs, online courses. As a result of that, we have a community of practitioners. Research is taking place in that area. Research in the field of MOOCs, visual analytics, and other, again, maybe related to the assessment, but maybe with rubrics, with special reference. And one interesting area that I found, and that is more interesting to me as well, is MOOCs in the area of educationally underserved. That remains very important area. How MOOCs can help deliver to those children who are less frequently go to school. They are prone to drop out. So they are disadvantaged children. How educationally underserved children can be benefited MOOCs? This is a very interesting area. Experiential learning in MOOCs is another area. Barriers to MOOCs, what may be technical, internet, technological aspects. So these kind of can also. Another interesting area is videos, for example. Videos is a central essential part. So how much? The recent studies are suggesting that the ideal is to have video to have, say for example, 2 to 6 minutes, not more than that. So a lot of research is being done in the field of video. What type of video? Now many of learning management systems, like for example Moodle, so allows you to have an interactive video. So a lot of research is being done in these areas. Forums, for example. See, forums become very interesting. It's not just about the instructor that is providing the knowledge. It's the participants that they are providing. So that becomes very interesting area of research. And various activities are there in the field of MOOCs. So that can also be researched. And satisfaction of learners, ultimately, it's meant for them. So whether, and scalability. Say for example, today, right now, in the middle of COVID-19 epidemic, we are all in lockdown scenario. Most of the institutions, HRDCs, they are providing, there is a huge demand from teachers to learn online courses, learning about online courses, how to design, develop, and deliver online courses. These are short courses at local level, but there is a need to have to conduct research at how to scale up such courses. Subject-wise, MOOCs is also a very interesting area in the field of medical, in the field of teacher education, it could be any area. And many more I found. But I was not happy and satisfactory to bring to you actually how to put when I was preparing this presentation, what actually I have to put when I'm talking about the research area of MOOCs. So I found interestingly two papers, very interesting two research papers I found. I would like to mention these two. This one is actually a slideshare presentation, how to research MOOCs, a primer with results. The reference has been given here. Later I'll copy the entire PPT of mine in this group. He says there are three stages of research when we talk about research in the field of MOOCs. Very interestingly, he makes three areas. One is three stages rather. One is early stage, second is intermediate stage, third is mature stage. In early stage, he classifies, categorizes studies like, for example, descriptive, explanatory, exploratory rather, sorry. Descriptive research in the sense, for example, what are MOOCs? What actually the MOOCs are? Who are taking them? Why do people take MOOCs? What happens in MOOCs? These type of, researcher himself is understanding here. It's exploratory, descriptive type of research. This author calls such type of research as early stages of research. Another type of research, he says the second stage, intermediate research. Here, he goes on putting correlation analysis. Reasons for enrolling, for example. Reasons for enrolling by demographics. Who are enrolling? From where they are enrolling? From their demographic backgrounds, can we study this? Analysis of subpopulation of learners. Success and completion, who is succeeding, who is failing kind of things. Here he calls them as correlation analysis. And third stage he calls this as mature stage, wherein he says research is to be done like controlled, comparative, experimental researches. This way, so I thought research in the field of MOOCs we can look in this way. Another interesting paper that I found, these two papers, they are a group of authors. These two papers have published in the span of a short time. One is in 2017 August, one is in February 2018. The first one, if I have to take, like for example, trends and patterns in massive open online courses, they have done a review between 2008 and 2015. It's very interesting. That helps us, this paper helps us also to go for to study the need for doing research in the field of MOOCs. So he says research areas of, especially this belong to distance education rather. So he says macro level, at macro level, the studies can be access, equity, ethics, globalization of education, cross-cultural aspects, distance teaching systems and institutions, theories and models. This is, he is talking about at macro level. Research methods in distance education and knowledge transfer, how it's all taking place. These five areas, they classify, categorize mainly as macro level when they talk about research areas of distance education. And another area, they say it is meso level, at management level, at organization level and technology. Here, they list these type of or this type of researches, like for example, management and organization, costs and benefits, educational technology, innovation and change, professional development and faculty support, learner support services, quality assurance kind of things. And another category is micro level, where in micro level, teaching and learning in distance education, they talk about, like for example, instructional design, interaction and communication in learning communities and learner characteristics. So that way we can, and the paper goes further and says the findings of the reveal that MOOC literature generally focuses on four lines of research according to them. They say the potential and challenges of MOOCs for universities is a very interesting area, MOOC platforms. There are a variety of platforms that they are providing. So there is an area of research one can go ahead and do on a platform of MOOCs wise. Learners and content in MOOCs and the quality of MOOCs and instructional design issues. But the interesting point they go on making is that the prospective researchers may use these results to gain an overview of this emerging field and as well as to explore potential research direction. This is what I wanted to put to you. Now, I would like to go to the last stage of my presentation, last part of my presentation before I go to question and answer. So that way I thought it is the last part, but question and answer part will also be there. Last part in the sense, this is the fourth part. Here I would like to talk about implications for education research. See, research in general, we can say that research in the area of MOOCs is taking place on technical aspects, pedagogical aspects, strategic aspects. Many more could be there. But very interestingly, very importantly, you and me, because we are in the field of teacher education, here it's very serious scope for research in the MOOCs in the area of educational research. When we talk about MOOC, essentially we talk about effective curriculum designing through technology. And we talk about integrating digital learning in the virtual classroom practices. And also, the essential things that you and me would like to take interest is about whether it's an offline course or online course. We essentially talk about domains of learning in our educational courses at B.Ed. level or M.Ed. level. We talk about domains of learning and aspects of curriculum we talk about. And also we talk about instructional planning and delivery. And very importantly, also we talk about the role of media in classroom communication and technology-enabled learning and self-learning. And of course, assessment and evaluation. So therefore, friends, I thought it is very important to put to you, before you, the introduction to MOOC, the idea of MOOC, then how quickly the rise of MOOCs has taken place and what is the recent trend that has taken place in the area of research and how we, you and me as a teacher educators get connected to with this. Especially when our colleges, our institutions, our departments, our universities are facing a challenge, adaptive challenges, for campus-based scholars and institutions, especially when we talk about B.Ed. and D.L.Ed. courses, when we talk about our M.Ed. courses, when we talk about Ph.D. courses. Because what I thought is, unless if you have to do research, unless you teach, you cannot do research. Therefore, my question is, are we teaching MOOCs? Are we teaching technology-enabled learning courses? So therefore, friends, there is a lot of area for all of us to think and get into this area because I thought we are still teaching the same way the education technology the way we were teaching, especially now that the world is changing suddenly after this COVID-19 pandemic. The structural changes that are going to take place in all other areas including education. Therefore, we leaders in education, being the leaders from teacher education, should be taking a leader role in research. So with this, I'll stop here and I would like to go for question answer, if any, because we have only 15 minutes left. I am able to see a few questions actually. Thank you, Pratim Maiti. Thank you, Mahipal Singh. Ramesh Kumar Pari. In Indian context, there is a rising trend of MOOCs in the past years. This session will be definitely useful for the faculty members of various departments. Thank you so much for your comments. Thank you, Madam Lalita Rao, for your comment. Rainu Gupta, she's is telling at micro level research can be done on the effect of these forces in different areas. I agree with you. There is a serious need to conduct at micro level what exactly takes place in these forces. I'm looking forward for more comments and questions, if any. We still have time, actually. I deliberately stopped at 4:45, thinking that I should give some time for discussion as well. So I'm waiting for comments, if any. The same person, Rainu Gupta, she has asked for what is the place of psychomotor domain. See, ultimately, domains of learning, whatever domains of learning, whether it's offline or online, ultimately the purpose of delivery of this course is you need to take care of all the domains. If you are failing in one domain, you are failing in all the domains. So therefore, that is why I've been telling that it's the teacher educators who play important role, vital role in making more effective the courses. It's not just about passing on the knowledge. It's not just about that students have paid some fees and they will come and go with the certificate. No. Even though there is a offline, even though there is no face-to-face interaction, there is no contact as such between a teacher and a student, still all the domains of learning can be taken up, provided you plan well, design well, develop well, deliver well the courses. That is why it is needed for doing a lot of research in this area. Dr. Somu Singh is advising me to take questions from starting. So I'm not able to see. Okay, 1 second, I'm loading. Okay, thank you, sorry. Ratnesh Kumar, thank you so much for your comment. He says, I am an educator and software developer. Recently, I am working on an open source learning management system. Great topic, he's telling. Thank you so much, Ratnesh Kumar. All the best to you. Kiran Dangwal, thank you so much for your comment. Anviti Rawat, thank you so much. I again would like to put across the participants to put any question. I'm there to clarify. Lalita Rao Garu, she has a question. Adaptations to feel comfortable with the digital platforms, please comment. It is very interesting, madam. Adaptation, not just from the student point of view, even teachers, instructors, we need to adapt to these newer environments. You and me, we are say, for example, just 1.5 month back, 2 month back, for example, there is suddenly a huge inflow of young students, primary school students, secondary school students, taking classes on Zoom. People are now calling it as a Zoom university. Suddenly, somehow young children are getting adapted. And we need to conduct a study on this, whether they are really enjoying, whether they are forced to get into such situation. Though I understand, I would like to say that the kind of online teaching that is taking place is not the one which is supposed to be, because they are not delivering, the teachers right now not delivering the class via trained media. It's a compelling situation. But in a normal situation, what happens? students have to adapt, teachers have to adapt. Things are changing. Now UGC, for example, is telling us that at least 20% of the courses, why don't you go for online courses? In our own university, we are planning, maybe next semester we will introduce, in our own department, we would like to introduce a course, online, fully online course, or at least blended course we would like to. So the essential thing is we need to change. Teachers first, we need to change. On the other hand, students are much faster actually in adjusting to newer environments. I thought, thank you madam for your this thing, question. If I have to see any more questions. Aarti Sharma, thank you so much for a fruitful presentation. Thank you, Aarti madam. Dr. Archana Srivastava, how can we build trust among students regarding various online? It's very interesting, madam. Dr. Archana Srivastava, how can we build trust among students regarding various online platforms? Madam, I take this question in a different sense. We don't have to. They are the best judges. Student will be able to judge and decide which platform to go for. So therefore, the best is to, if we are creating a platform, if we are creating a MOOC, if we are creating, we should put our best of our efforts and the rest it will take care. Yes, in the beginning, we need to, they need a hand-holding. Students need some orientation. For example, when you are delivering through whatever platform you are delivering the course, they need some basic understanding how to get into the course. Once you enroll, how to interact, how to introduce yourself in the course, those kind of things, how to submit assignments, how to take quiz, how to submit assignments. These kind of orientation, little bit orientation only required, but once they start using it, they can go ahead like anything. I thought I have answered you, Madam Dr. Archana Srivastava. Manju Gupta, Madam, how it is different from Moodle to be used in the classrooms? Madam, Moodle, you can very well, very interesting question you have asked. You can effectively, very effectively use Moodle as a learning management system. You can go for a blended learning. You can take normal classes. You can integrate Moodle. You can enroll all the your class students. Say for example, you have 50 students in your class. If less than 50, you can use the normal Moodle cloud. If more than 50, Nomio site is there, up to 250. In the beginning, you don't have to buy or purchase versions of these Moodles. And Moodle, to best of my knowledge, is one of the best user-friendly in the sense it's very easy for a teacher also to make courses, and it's very easy for student to interact. You as a teacher design your own course. You can deliver your own, develop your own course. You can design your own course. You can bring in interactive videos here. You can create your own videos. You can bring in your own audio files without purchase of any extra softwares. With the help of open education softwares, even you can bring in all open educational resources that are available, best of videos that are available. If not, some of the videos you can simply put the URL also you can give. So madam, best of the things can be delivered through Moodle. It's the right time for anyone to get into this. Before we go for the next semester, before we go for next term, we right now we can prepare a course from Moodle. Most of the HRDCs now they are organizing courses on MOOCs, 2 days, 3 days courses. In 2 days time, 3 days time, one may not be able to become perfect advanced learner. So they need to practice. And on YouTube, there are a lot of demonstration videos are available. One can self-learn how to use this Moodle very effectively. So madam, I thought I have answered your question. How is to be used? You can very well use in the classroom. अर्चना गौतम मैडम थैंक यू सो मच, जानकी सुधा थैंक यू सो मच मैडम. बिकॉज टू फ्रेम अवर ओन कोर्स मे नॉट बी सो वेल एक्सेप्टेड इन अवर एजुकेशन सिस्टम. मंजू मैडम शी कंटिन्यूस विद अ कमेंट दैट बिकॉज टू फ्रेम अवर ओन कोर्स मे नॉट बी सो वेल एक्सेप्टेड इन अवर एजुकेशन सिस्टम. मैडम इन द बिगिनिंग इट्स पार्ट एंड पार्सल. It is very much common to any systems. When we begin, there will be some critics, but we should, I think, in my personal opinion, I think we should go ahead. We should do it. We should create our own course. I tell you, creating a course, your students will appreciate you. Students will support you. Students will enjoy. Students, you take the feedback from the student later. It is so transparent. Assignments can be so transparent, quiz so transparent, internal assessment marks so transparent, excellent. You can bring the best of the videos into your courses. You can even bring in the live sessions. Big blue button possibility is there. You can have a conference within the classroom. You can bring in other teachers into your classrooms. So therefore, the most important part is to create your own course without hesitation. That is what I thought we should go ahead. Rainu Gupta madam, now pedagogy is changing in the classrooms also, but MOOCs are helpful. Yes, very much true. Pedagogy is changing. Pedagogy is very much transformative compared to those days. Now, see, I tell you my own experience. I am teaching for 18 years. I am into 19 years of teaching. Students in the beginning, when I started my teaching career, students now altogether there is a different. Students used to ask many questions. Students now are asking less questions. I thought, what may be the reason? One of the reasons, you may agree with me, is that those days teachers used to be the most important source for their knowledge. Now no, they will ask less and less questions. Unless it is really exciting, they won't ask questions, because most of the questions they have answers, better answers rather, from their own smartphones. They can quickly search and they will get best of the answers. So they would like to interact with the teacher only when it is really exciting. So therefore, madam, pedagogy, whether in terms of online or offline, is changing. So therefore, we need to cater to the needs of the students in terms of. Thank you. I request viewer to please ask questions. Admin Dr. Somu Singh is requesting. Is MOOC applicable to teach foundation subjects like philosophy? Dr. Ravala Krishna is asking a very interesting question. Philosophy. It is very difficult for me to answer because I never taught philosophy paper, but I don't think so. Paper like philosophy cannot be taught through MOOCs. I tell you, I know papers like music are being taught, dance classes are being taught through online. So why not philosophy? Rather, it's a, as a teacher of philosophy, it is your creativity, your innovation. How you will see, there are a lot of material that are available in the internet in terms of open educational resources. You can rather enrich your course by going online. At least to begin with, you can say, for example, you can go in a blended manner. Some portion you teach offline, some portion you teach through online. If I have any more questions, I would like to go for. Dr. Sunil Sharma, MOOC is still in its primary stage in India. Am I right? Will it replace traditional mode in a country like India? See, I agree with you, it's in a beginning stage, primary stage, but let me tell you, this is a recurring question, that is it going to replace the teacher? More than that question is, we as a teachers, there is a need for transforming ourselves. Like these days, students, they talk about web 1.0. Now they are into web 2.0. Now they will be moving to 3.0. We teachers also have to move. We have to take ourselves to a higher level, transformative. So I thought I answered most of the questions that are appearing here, and with kind permission from all the participants and the admin, Dr. Somu Singh, I would like to stop here with a thanking note, especially to Dr. Somu Singh, who has given me this opportunity to me. It was a wonderful opportunity to interact on such a large-scale teacher educators group. According to me, it's one of the biggest in our country. So with that note, I thank each one of you. See you some other time. Thank you.